We're very pleased to have Dr. John Jackson, director and founder of the Turin Shroud Center of Colorado, TSC, was the leader of the 1978 30-person plus high-tech scientific American expedition that examined the Shroud firsthand. He holds a PhD in physics from the U.S. Naval Postgraduate School and a bachelor's degree in religious studies from the College of Santa Fe, New Mexico, I presume. Dr. Jackson has published over 78 papers, 21 of which concern the Shroud of Turin. Mrs. Rebecca Jackson, his lovely wife, is an associate director of the TSC and holds a BA in Germanic Studies and Literature from Brooklyn College of the City University of New York. Both Dr. and Mrs. Jackson have delivered presentations on the Shroud at major international conferences, including those in Rome, Oviedo, Spain, San Marino, and Nice, and have given numerous television, radio, and newspaper interviews around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please give a very warm welcome to Dr. Jackson and his wife, Rebecca.
Thank you very much for welcoming us graciously to this wonderful conference, which we have found very interesting here. What we're going to talk about this evening is what you see over here, the Shroud of Turin. And I've entitled my part of the presentation, Where Science and Faith Meet. And I think that's very true, and as we go through this, I hope you will begin to appreciate that. We're going to be talking about some science, and we're also going to be talking about how the Shroud can help illuminate us in our faith. Okay, well, let's go ahead and begin. First, I'd like to talk about the image. Get my little arrow out of there. In particular, I want to talk about the color, the negative, and the so-called three-dimensional representations of the Shroud of Turin. This is basically, we're starting with science, the scientific part of this. But this is what the cloth looks like. It's a rectangular cloth. Its ratio of its width to its length is 1:4, almost exactly, which in and of itself is significant because this would be a fairly strong indicator that this cloth was made according to some unit of measure. If we use the simple feet and inch measurement, the Shroud comes out to be 14 feet 3 inches long by 3 feet 7 inches wide. Not very interesting, but if you express the dimensions of this cloth in terms of the cubit, the Jewish cubit that was used at the time of Christ, certainly, then that measure, which is 21.7 inches per cubit, translates to be almost exactly 8 cubits long by 2 cubits wide, the 1:4 ratio. But that's probably not an accident. Even the dimensions of this cloth signal to us that this is likely something very old and is certainly consistent with the time of Christ. But to the uninitiated, the thing that stands out the most on the cloth are the two parallel lines that run the length of the cloth, and these are the result of a fire that the Shroud suffered in the year 1532. You can see various patches that are sewn over holes burnt through the Shroud at that time. You can see the charred and discoloration patterns that you see on the cloth. The Shroud suffered a very serious damage at that time. But the thing that's the most important to us are the two images that lie between the two parallel burn marks. You see the frontal image here, the dorsal image of what appears to be an adult human form laid out in death. So that's the image that we're going to be talking about that's going to hold our interest this evening. Let's look at the dorsal image first. That's the back part of the body imprint. So we're looking at half the Shroud, which I just showed you. Well, you can see at the very top the back part of the head, the shoulders, the buttocks, the calves, the soles of the feet. again, sandwiched between the two parallel lines. Now, as we will see in more detail later, the blood marks, which are superimposed upon the brownish image of the man of the shroud, correlate very nicely with what the Gospels tell us happened to Jesus during his passion. For example, top of the head, we see some what appears to be matted blood in the hair that has been imprinted onto the cloth. This would be consistent with a crown of thorns. From the top of the shoulders all the way to the bottom of the ankles, we see that the entire back is literally peppered with many wounds that frankly look like whipping or scourging. I don't know how else to explain what we're looking at other than that. And then at the bottom of the feet, you can see some blood residues with a blood trickle coming off the dorsal foot. And this again would be consistent with a nail wound in the bottom of the feet that has been left for us onto the Shroud of Turin. Now, let's go to the, let me point out one more thing. Midway on the shroud, you see these patterns. These are not from the 1532 fire. These actually are burn penetrations of the cloth that predate 1532. We know that because there is, for example, a drawing of the shroud made in 1516, 16 years before the 1532 fire, which show these marks. So it's from a different fire, from a different event, and I just want to whet your appetite because that will turn out to be quite significant to us as we talk about some other aspects of the shroud later on. The frontal image, well, it's you can see a sort of a ghostly looking face, brownish image onto the cloth, pectorals of the chest, crossed arms, there's elongated fingers, legs coming down here. The body image is brown, a yellow-brown discoloration, but we can do actually better than that in our description if we compare the color of this image to the nearby flared or burn areas caused by the 1532 fire. Visually, the color and character of what we see on the shroud looks identical to what the discolorations show us over here. In fact, when I was in Turin as part of the scientific expedition in 1978, I intentionally looked at that area, those areas, and I tried to see a difference with my eyes at that time, and I could not. The shroud image indeed looks exactly like the way the shroud is when it is scorched. And that's interesting because from a scientific point of view, it might be from this observation that the chemistry of the body image is somehow related or similar to the chemistry of the way the shroud linen is when it is scorched by heat. So let's keep that in mind as we go into the scientific descriptions. We also have blood patterns that are superimposed upon this image as well. Again, at the top of the head, we find puncture-type blood-like wounds, again reminiscent or consistent with a crown of thorns. We have a wound in the side, almost destroyed by the burning of the 1532 fire. This would correlate with the side wound that is mentioned in the Gospels. We have a blood wound at the base of the wrist. We have blood wounds going up both forearms. These are, of course, consistent with crucifixion. And we also have another blood wound right down here that is also consistent with the idea of crucifixion, the piercing of the wrist areas and the foot areas. We can now take that image and we can exaggerate it either by computer or photographically. When we do that, you can now see very clearly the body image. See, normally, going back, the shroud image itself is very faint. We measured in Turin that the difference of reflectivity on a scale of 0 to 100, the difference in reflectivity of the facial or the body image to the cloth background is only 7%. So if this is a very faint image that you see onto the cloth. But we can make up for that photographically or by computer. And so we produce this image that we can examine. Now here you can see very clearly the elongated fingers, which may have been hard for you to see beforehand. Now, in 1898, the shroud was photographed for the first time. In the process of looking at the photographs, in particular the negative, something very dramatic was discovered about the shroud. A negative, as you all know, I think you know, is that you can interchange the shades of light and dark. So here we see a dark image on a light cloth, but in a negative, you can reverse that and show a light image on a dark cloth background. Just invert the two together. And when you do that, look what happens. That image suddenly jumps to life to us. It gives us something that looks very photographic-like. Yet, this image has no more information, scientific information, than this one does. It's just a different way to display it. So when we do this, you suddenly see what looks like a physically reasonable and realistic human form of photographic-like quality. I must say that in 1898, when this was first shown, it raised a number of scientific eyebrows. In 1902, this subject was debated. The shroud was actually presented at the French Academy of Sciences in the Sorbonne. And Professor Yves Delage argued that what we're looking at here is, in fact, the image of Jesus, who he simply regarded as a historic personage. He was not a Christian. But nevertheless, he believed that we are looking at the historic burial cloth of Christ. And of course, that's going to be something that is very interesting for science to look at. We do not accept the authenticity of the shroud on faith. We must do it on reason. And that reason must be illuminated by direct observations of this cloth, and we can use the scientific method, which is a logically coherent way of analyzing observational data to come up with our results. And that's exactly the train of thought that we will use here and what we use in looking at the shroud. But there's another quality of the shroud which I actually had the privilege of discovering back in 1976, 2 years before our scientific examination, along with at the invitation of another scientist, Bill Modern of Sandia National Laboratories, we subjected this image to a image processing technique whereby you can convert image intensity to three-dimensional relief. There's nothing mysterious or magical about that. You can do it to any image whatsoever, but the idea is that we can apply this to the shroud and convert all levels of brightness that you see distributed over the cloth to make this image and plot it by an analog computer to give you a three-dimensional relief representation of that intensity structure. So when we convert the brightness of the shroud image to doing that, here's what happens. We get that. Where the shroud is bright, the cloth or the image is plotted in three-dimensional relief. And what's interesting about this is that the three-dimensional brightness surface of the shroud image looks like a physiologically reasonable three-dimensional body shape. Notice that the nose is in proper three-dimensional relief proportion relative to the cheeks, which is in proper relief proportion relative to the eye sockets and so forth. In other words, what you're looking at here seems to be anatomically reasonable, and most images, just photographic images that you would do this to, do not have this quality. They're very distorted in the three-dimensional sense. But it happens here on the Shroud of Turin. Let's look at the face. The face image on the shroud. You've got the nose, which is brighter than the cheeks, brighter than the eye sockets. So when you subject that brightness distribution that creates the image for us as we see it to three-dimensional relief by the computer, where the shroud is bright, it's plotted highest. So the nose is plotted higher than the cheeks because the nose is brighter than the cheeks. You see how that works. So this is purely an image. It's just purely another way to display the image on the shroud. But what it's telling us is that the image on the Shroud of Turin, the intensity of this, was made by a process that was able to correlate intensity or discolorations on the cloth with apparently cloth-to-body distances, assuming that this cloth indeed covered a body when this image was formed. And that's very important from a scientific point of view because it takes us out of the realm of this was the work of an artist. Because you would have to postulate an artist who could not even follow or track the progress of his work to put an image on the shroud that is only with, and he can only work within 7% reflectivity variation. And experiments that we've done with forensic artists show that this just doesn't seem, is not possible to do, and do it consistently to the level that you're seeing it here. So the shroud is a very important object in its own right scientifically, but I would tell you that this discovery, along with the photographic negative discovery, led us to a scientific expedition that occurred during the dates of October 9th through 13th of 1978 in Turin, Italy. And as was stated, I did have the privilege of leading that team of scientists. That's actually yours truly right there, along with part of our team, in the testing room before the shroud was brought to us to make measurements with it with a wide variety of scientific data. Now, I'd like to tell you, I'd like you to notice that the room in which these examinations were performed was very nice. You had red silk on the walls. You have the gold trim along the various parts of the windows and doors and so forth. You have a nice inlaid floor that we got to work on. You can't really see it, but there was a nice painting, angels and so forth, above the floor and so forth, the gold chandelier. The reason I like to show this picture is because I like everybody to know what kind of laboratory I'm used to working in. Anyway, the shroud at that time was on exposition for the third time in 1978. It was on exposition for the third time in the 20th century. The shroud was taken off exposition. People on the other side of this door said goodbye to the shroud, thinking it was going to be put away, but actually it was going to be brought to where we were to do our scientific examination. It's wrapped in red silk. Then it's laid on top of the a table. Behind, we have a table in the vertical position, which was being covered with gold mylar for protective purposes on the shroud. Now, you might look at it and say, well, gee, over here, it looks like, what happened there? There's no gold protective mylar over there. Well, you're right, there isn't. But when this picture was being taken by our documenting photographer, Barry Schwartz, there was another person who I don't know who it was standing next to him, and I was standing next to both of them. And that person made an interesting observation, which I'll pass on to you. You see, the reason why we don't have gold mylar here is because somebody was in another back room madly putting gold mylar on the plates here before we put the shroud up on it. So we're working on it. We're going to do it. But the comment that the person made next to me when this picture was taken was, you know, we're bringing the shroud here. The person says, you know, you're never really ready when he comes. And so There's a little bit of theology in science as well, so you take a lesson from that. So then, the next thing that happened, we took the shroud off the table, put it onto the our own testing table. Again, that's yours truly, and some other people, the late Dr. Max Fry, Tom DiMahala, my then colleague many years ago, Eric Jumper. There's late Don Lynn from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Vern Miller is taking pictures. He's a chairman of scientific and technical photography at Brooks Institute and so forth. We had quite an impressive team ready to study the shroud. But anyway, we're organizing the shroud at this point, and then the first thing we did was to measure the thickness of the shroud. So I did that. The answer was 345 microns, about 0.3 millimeters thickness. That's important if you're going to worry about some physical properties, physical studies of the shroud. We've used that number for a number of studies. Next thing that happened was some tape samples were removed from the shroud by sticky tape. This is the late Dr. Max Fry, who was removing the samples. And what he wanted to do was to analyze pollen powders that are or particles that could be collected from the tape extraction on the surface, such as this. What he had found, and this is the only, I apologize for the primitive looking chart here. Rebecca keeps telling me, threatening, I guess, to remake this on Excel, on Excel and make a real nice graph. We need to do that, honey. But anyway, this was the pollen spectrum that Max Fry deduced from his samples. And head and shoulders above all the other was the pollen distribution coming from Jerusalem area, which is botanically apparently a very unique area of flora that grow, and these types of pollens, he says, he has found on the Shroud of Turin, which is very interesting because that would then link the shroud itself to the Middle East and particularly the Jerusalem area, which would be very interesting. We took scientific photographs of the shroud. We calibrated the photographs with density step wedges. Vern Miller stood behind with his pulse xenon flash lamps and a Hasselblad camera on a special rail system that could move from point to point to point. And we could make a photo mosaic of the shroud with this. Again, for scientific purposes, these are not pretty pictures. These are for scientific purposes. We took pictures with different types of filtrations and so forth to be able to get what we need. Okay, I've introduced these photographs to you once before. I don't need to talk about it again. But there was another type of photography that was also employed during our examination, which was counterpoised to this type of photography. This one is what we would call reflected light imagery. There you are taking light, or let me put it this way, the camera and the light source are on the same side of the shroud. So the only way the camera can see what's here is by light that's reflected from the light source from the shroud back into the camera. Now, the next picture I'm going to show you is what the shroud looks like when you instead put the light source behind the shroud to keep the camera where it is. So now the light is going to pass through the cloth. So what we're going to be looking at is, instead of a reflection image, we're going to be looking at an absorption image of light relative to the shroud. And this is what that same image, same scale, everything looks like. It looks like that. So we can toggle back and forth between the two. And let's see what we can see. Well, we can see the damage of the 1532 fire. In transmission light, we can see the extent of the burn damage. See here, and you go back to the over here, all you see is the patch, but the transmitted light looks through that, and you can see the hole in the shroud. We can see this. That is a water stain. You also see it on the reflected light as well. But you can see in transmission light very easily a simple water stain on the cloth. Look over here. We have the side wound. Going back, the side wound in reflected light, you see it in transmitted light as something very dark. Let's look over here. You can see the burn areas from the 1532 fire. That's those right there. They are nice and dark because they penetrate all the way through the cloth. But over in this area, guess what? No image. Or if you're used to looking at the shroud, you can just barely make out the body image. The body image is there. There it is. But notice the body image in reflected light has the same intensity as the 1532 fire scorch mark. But in transmitted light, the scorch areas are much darker than the body image. Very, very different. What does that tell you? It tells you, this is the only conclusion possible, is that the discolorations that you're looking at on the shroud must be superficial. They do not penetrate through the thickness of the cloth. So the image on the shroud, from this simple optical experiment, resides only on the surface fibrils of the threads that are woven together to make the shroud. And that's very important when you start thinking up scientific hypotheses to try to explain how this image was formed. So this is a very important thing to think about. And there's the actual comparison. Again, body image in reflected light, same intensity as the scorch areas. Transmitted light, body image, essentially transparent relative to the dark scorch images of the 1532 fire. We could confirm this independently by using our binocular microscope that was mounted on a special rail system, again, that we could look at any place on the shroud we wanted to and then photograph it. So let's look at what we see. Okay, first of all, through the binocular microscope, this is a picture of what the background of the shroud looks like. Okay? Now let's point out a few things. Notice how generally white the background of the cloth looks like. Notice that the shroud has an interesting weave to it. It's called a 3-in-1 herringbone twill. So, for example, take this thread that's running this way. The thread goes over three perpendicular threads, under one, over three, under one. So here's your three. One, two, three. It's that 3-in-1, over three, under one, over three, under one. 3-in-1 herringbone twill that makes up the Shroud of Turin. Now, the next picture I'm going to show you is what the shroud looks like, same magnification, but at the tip of the nose. So we're going to look at the tip of the nose, the same magnification. And what I want you to look for is the change in color, that happens when we go from one to the other. And then I want you to concentrate on what is it that is carrying that color? Where does that color reside? Is it residing on little particles? Is it residing on paint that you can see, which you should see at that magnification, or what? So let's do that. So we're going from the background to the tip of the nose. Boom. See the difference in color? Notice that we do not see any particulate matter. We do not see anything that looks like pigmentation or paint that's making up this image. In fact, what it looks like is that the individual fibrils, look at this fibril fuzz here that's obviously discolored. The individual fibrils are not cemented together. They are individually colored by whatever it was that put this image onto the Shroud of Turin. It is therefore impossible to hold the idea that this shroud was the result of a painting by what I've shown you this far. If it was a painting, realizing that the image does not go through the cloth, that in itself would have to imply that the paint, if it was there, would have to be on the surface. It would have to be thick enough not to be able to penetrate through the cloth. If it resides on the surface of the cloth, where is it? It is not there. So there's an important hypothesis, or set of hypotheses, i.e. this is a painting, that we can dispense with this simple observation. We have other techniques that also dispute that hypothesis as well, but here we go with something that everybody can, I think, understand. Again, looking close at the tip of the nose, individual fibrils are colored, and the image resides only on the surface of the threads. Now, when we go to the blood areas, we're going to see a quite different picture, because when we go to a blood area here, we now see material that has accumulated, that is cementing fibrils together. The blood images on the shroud, which are a different color, are reddish in color, and they are encrusted right onto the top of the cloth. We also see something very interesting as well. We find areas like right here, for example. There's many areas like here, like here, like here, where it appears as though this reddish material, which I'm going to call blood for now, and I'll tell you why we think it's blood later, that this material has caked off, it has come off over the period of time, and when that has happened, we find that underneath the threads appear to be white. They appear to be more like that than they do like that. See how white they are? What that means is that the blood evidently went onto the shroud before the body image. And you might say, well, that makes sense. The shroud enfolds a wounded body. The blood is immediately transferred, and then later comes the body image. Yeah, that's true, and that's sensible if that's the sequence. But you want to start, you don't want to start with preconceived ideas here. Think about it from the point of view of the artist. Is he going to put the blood on the shroud first? In other words, to say, gee, I want to put, over here I'm going to put the wound in the feet, then over here I'm going to speckle I'm going to put the scourge marks. Oh, down here I'm going to put where I want to have the crown of thorns, then the wound in the side, and so forth. Here the wound in the wrist, and make little trickles where I think where the forearms are going to be. And then after I do that, I'm going to put on the shroud the body image, but I'm going to put it on the shroud in a way that discolors the cloth rather than puts a colored material on it. And by the way, I'm going to hold myself to a 7% difference in reflectivity. And oh yeah, I'm going to encode this in such a way that it's going to have photographic-like realism in case someday they invent photography. And also, in case they invent computers someday, I'm going to encode that intensity levels with three-dimensional cloth-to-body distance information. I'm going to make a forgery here that is going to pass what people want. That'd be a pretty neat trick, to say the least. But that's what we're seeing on the Shroud of Turin. Another kind of photography that we used was called ultraviolet fluorescence photography. This is the kind of photography that you would use to if you go to a museum and you go look at minerals and you go into a dark room and it's called black light. You don't see the light because it's ultraviolet. The human eye can't see that. So then, you what the ultraviolet light does is it causes the minerals to glow with all these pretty colors. Well, that's what we're doing here. This is reflected light. This is ultraviolet fluorescence light. Turns out that the body image does not fluoresce. which also discounts a hypothesis that has been around or been proposed for the last 25 years by a microscopist who just recently passed away from Chicago, who said that the Shroud of Turin was an iron oxide pigment in a vehicle of gelatin. Well, gelatin fluoresces, really fluoresces. It'll shine like everything, like with those minerals. The Shroud of Turin image is not doing that. The UV fluorescence photographs were very good because they were the highest contrast images that we were able to take. Now, if we go to, for example, this area right here, this is the top of the head. The top of the head, as you can see from either picture, we have a what looks like a little three blood. And that is well known on the shroud, but if we go close with our UV fluorescence photograph, we find something interesting. We find that here's that three blood, but we find that it doesn't end there. It appears to continue on in this region. So the actual blood flow that was on the head, and this is my interpretation of this, I should add, was all of this plus this. And then for whatever reason, the shroud, when it covered the body, contacted only this part of that blood clot, so there was blood transfer that occurred. But what about this? Well, this appears to be the same kind of color change that is characteristic of the body image, the hair or the skin areas. In other words, my take on this is that the blood, like the hair, like the skin, was able to make images of itself when the cloth was not exactly in contact or direct contact with the blood. Now, trying to imagine what kind of mechanism could do something like that is not easy. But I think that's what's going on in the Shroud of Turin. Let's go to the dorsal image using the UV fluorescence photographs. In particular, I want to look at the upper part of the back, or actually the middle back, and what we find there is something very interesting. We find that the back is covered by these dumbbell-shaped type of blood stains. Moreover, in the UV fluorescence photographs, we see that these blood stains resolve themselves into tiny little scratches. Now, nobody on our team, including myself, when we saw the shroud, we were there for 5 days, were able to look at that, the shroud, and say, gosh, look at those little scratches that are associated with the blood stains on the back, the scourge wounds on the back. We didn't see it. It took the UV fluorescence photography to show that to us. And this is entirely reasonable from the standpoint of a scourging. And I think I have an instrument. Yes. Archaeologically, the kind of instruments that were used by the Romans were like dumbbell-shaped. And those kinds of instruments, if they were had little rough edges on them, could very easily cause what we're seeing on the shroud. It's reasonable. But it's subliminal. You don't necessarily see that. So, The point is, if this was a forgery, why should something be there that is entirely reasonable? Why should it be there if you can't see it and the artist couldn't see it, presumably? But it's there. That makes the Shroud of Turin look reasonable. It looks realistic in many ways. This is just one of many examples why this cloth looks like it's portraying to us a real crucifixion. Crown of thorns. Well, this is an example of some thorns that come from Israel. Here is the top of the head. We've color exaggerated the image so you can see the blood images more clearly, but notice that they do tend to come like puncture type sources. Again, consistent, doesn't prove, but it's consistent with this being those wounds being what they appear to be, that is the wounds of Christ on this cloth. Let's go back to the back image, In particular, I'd like to go to the dorsal shoulder area. So we're looking at the top of the shoulders here, the head would be up here, and then the back area that I just showed you is down here, and the buttocks are down here. I want to look at these scourge wounds over here. In particular, let's look at these from the UV fluorescence point of view. On the back, these wounds are nice and sharp. They have nice sharp edges to them. Here's a dumbbell-shaped one, here's another one. They seem to be nice and sharp, but when you go to the shoulder, the upper part of the shoulder, the same wounds that you see here suddenly start getting smeared and smudged. Now, why would that be? Well, I'll offer one speculation, hypothesis, if you will, that assuming this is the burial cloth of Christ, we know that our Lord was carried a cross. Generally, what this was done, it's not the big T cross that you see being dragged along in religious art. It's too heavy, and that's not the way it was done. What he would carry, or the condemned would carry, would be just the cross beam. The vertical part was already there, because they would use this over and over again. It's in place. So he'd carry the patibulum, as it was called, and then you would carry this, and then as you carry it, it's logical that that heavy cross beam on the shoulder area could start to smudge those scourge wounds. And I think that's exactly, or at least that's consistent with that idea that the Gospels tell us. So that could add, the smudging could be literally from the carrying of the cross. The nailing. Contrary to popular art, which is consistent throughout the ages, the man of the shroud's nailing is in the wrist area, not in the palm of the hand as we see it. Now we're looking at the back side of this. There's still some debate among some doctors as to where that nail comes here. The exit wound is clear, it's over here. But putting the nail like you see here is surrounded by bony materials which are tied together with ligaments, and you could affix somebody to the cross with nails only and the person would not come off. If you nailed the person exclusively through the palm of the hand, all you have is tissue areas that would rip through. Your fingers, by the way, on your hand are only this part. But your fingers actually, the metacarpals go all the way up to this region. If you want to feel your hand, you can feel those bones in there. But that's what it would look like. And that's what we see on the shroud. And the shroud has it right. Artistic tradition has it wrong. Here we go. The fingers on the elongated fingers on the man of the shroud, the forearms. You have a blood wound here in that wrist area that I just showed you, the blood coming down this way, and then blood trickles coming that way. Is that consistent with any with reality? Again, the UV fluorescence photographs to the rescue. Let's look at this blood wound closer. There it is, normal reflectance. Here it is under ultraviolet fluorescence. I want you to call your attention to the very tip of this blood mark in the UV fluorescence. Notice that right around the tip, we have this very evident clear halo. You don't see it in the reflected light, but it's there in the UV fluorescence light. Our scientific team basically unanimously agreed that what you're looking at here is blood that, while in the position on the cross, gravity has acted to pull the serum, the clear part of the blood, to separate it, which does happen in blood. We've shown that in experiments. That serum will pool at the very tip of the blood, of the clot, by gravity, such that when you take the cloth and touch it to the wrist wound, the blood is transferred and that serum is transferred and then migrates a short distance into the cloth by capillary action. And that's what we're seeing. And then the existence of that very thin, watery or aqueous liquid from the serum on the cloth at that location evidently prevented the body image from being formed right there, although the body image was formed down in here. In other words, whatever it was that made the image on the shroud, it couldn't act through that little coating of serum, and that's why we see it. So we're learning things about this image that we have to understand if we're going to try to describe how this image was formed. Now, if you look at the blood clot now on the wrist wound, noting that this direction that I'm pointing it has to be gravity because of the gravitational separation of the serum, and also just the way the clot actually looks, the fingers are pointing down of the clot. That's gravity. So if we orient the forearm and the fingers such that that is vertical, that is very consistent with what happens on crucifixion. So the blood clots on the man of the shroud, certainly on the wrist, are very consistent with crucifixion. This would be the death position, by the way, that we've reconstructed from a volunteer cadet. Oh, that's right. It was a cadet at the Air Force Academy from Ohio. Nevertheless, in fact, we ran across him. He's an officer in the Air Force now, several months ago. We had also from Ohio, I might say, from the biostereometrics lab, the director came out. I think it's Akron, Ohio. Came out and took stereo photographs at our shroud center of the cadet in our crucifixion position of a real cross. We didn't nail him, by the way. We had padded wrist supports. I've been on this cross as well, hanging here. Let me tell you a little bit about that, what it's like. People don't realize it is very, even with the padded wrist supports just hanging there, to do that is really quite uncomfortable. You can just, I can't imagine what it'd be like to have a nail there supporting yourself. It's very uncomfortable. But there's another aspect of this. You feel, when you're up there like this, you feel very vulnerable, very helpless. You feel like you're ready to fall off this thing. You can't, but you feel like you're going to. It's very uncomfortable from a psychological point of view. Anybody can do anything they want to you from that position. And so it's really very, psychologically, very, very distressing. When we were doing this is back 1985, we were doing some of these little experiments. There was an archaeologist from Boulder who just met us that same day. And he had come down because he heard we were going to do this. And he was a likable kind of guy. And he says, hey, I'd like to get up on that. I want to see what that's like. So he got up on it. And when he first got up there, I mean, anybody can do anything for a couple minutes, right? Yeah, okay. So he's up there, and he was sort of clowning around up there. So, you know, it's not too bad, this kind of stuff. He says, this isn't so bad. Well, my colleague, who was kind of had a dry sense of humor, said, oh, really? It's not too bad, huh? Well, what would you think if we close the door, turn off the lights, and we'll say, see you next Monday? This was Saturday night. And this guy's up here like this. He stopped cold. His blood drained from his face. It suddenly dawned on him that he's stuck. He's stuck, and he's helpless. And he says, get me down from here right now. He wanted to get down right now. And I think that underscores the psychology of being up there on that cross, that it is an incredibly traumatic psychological experience to be up there when you are put up there by your enemies, not by your friends. And that's what happened to Jesus. It was the Romans who put him up there on the cross, and they were not obviously doing it as a little experiment. He was up there to die. And that's just something that you don't realize unless you do these kinds of experiments. Wound in the side, the lance wound goes through the ribs. There we have it. You can see that the opening had to have been here. The blood flow is downwards, and you have the sort of a convex curvature which corresponds to the cross-section of a lance or a knife or whatever. This wound is very important because if you draw a perpendicular from this wound, which you have to for the knife, it goes right into the heart region. Christianity needs this wound. And the reason it needs this wound is because we have to present a dead Christ. Because without a dead Christ, the resurrection which follows would not make any sense. It would not be believed. You have to have a dead Christ. And the Shroud of Turin with this wound right here, thank God it wasn't destroyed by the 1532 fire, shows us a dead Christ. This is very important. The people of Islam in the Quran claim that Jesus did not die on the cross. We have archaeological evidence, if this is the burial cloth of Christ, that he did die on the cross. The Quran is wrong, Muhammad is wrong. And I think that needs to be made known to people of the world, including the people of that religion. We can bury somebody, we can wrap somebody up in the cloth. We have a three-dimensional person. No, this is not a real person that you're looking at here. But it was a person who volunteered to be CAT scanned. And then volunteers at the Air Force Academy made this replica so that we could do some various experiments. We can wrap the shroud around him, and then we can see how well things correspond. Now, we're going to do that here for you very easily just by the toggling of my mouse here. So we can go to this. We can just toggle back and forth and watch. We can say, look at the wounds, the blood flows on the forearm. See, they're right on the forearm. The wound in the side is right here. The blood wound at the tip of the shroud is right here. That's at the instep of the foot, and so forth. So we can just toggle back and forth, and we can see how well the Shroud of Turin image corresponds to draping over a cloth. I think that this is conclusive, coupled with the three-dimensional quality of the image I showed you, that this shroud covered anatomically a three-dimensionally reasonable human body. The question is, whose body? And I'll let Rebecca talk a little bit about that too, from the Jewish point of view. We did x-rays of the shroud. We have an x-ray source. We passed x-rays through the cloth. Here's what one looks like. Here's another one. This is the x-ray of the hand region. Where's the hands? Answer, they don't show up. We can see the structure of the shroud. We can see the holes in the shroud. We can see water stains on the shroud in the x-rays. But we can't see the image. Not at all. If this image was an iron oxide painting, that iron should absorb that x-rays. We should see an image there. We don't. X-ray fluorescence. The x-rays could excite different parts of the image in the blood. Here's a typical body image area. Here's a scan from a blood area. The big difference is this spike right here. That spike corresponds to the K-alpha line, thank you, the K-alpha line of iron. Reconstruction experiments in Los Alamos, glad you pay attention. Reconstruction experiments at the Los Alamos National Laboratory show that the intensity of this peak is consistent with the iron density of whole blood. Interesting. Doesn't prove it's blood, but it's certainly consistent with it. We took spectrometric data. Another husband and wife team, Roger and Marty Gilbert, from Connecticut, then president of Oriel Corporation, made spectroscopic equipment, optical equipment. They made this. The spectrometer would put light of varying wavelengths or colors onto the cloth, reflected off, and measured the reflected intensity. Here's the results. reflective intensity versus wavelength or color. For your orientation, these wavelengths here, 400 nanometers is blue, your 700 nanometer is basically red, and all the colors of the rainbow in between here. What you find is that when you compare a reflectance curve for the body image, the top curve, with the scorched areas from the 1532 fire, that within the precision of the experiment given by these arrows, the variation of those two curves compared to one another is basically indistinguishable. We even see the same hump repeated at about 425 nanometers over here. This is very strong presumptive evidence that the chemistry of the body image is indeed like linen is, that is the linen of the shroud, when it is scorched, when it's thermally discolored, like taking a hot iron and putting it on the cloth and discoloring it. Blood, on the other hand, its color characteristics is much different. Most of the reflective power is in the long wavelengths or the red. Well, that's why it looks red. Very different. The blood and body images are different. Now, let's go to those hands again. Remember we talked about the elongated fingers? And now this is really very significant. Here are the crossed hands. What I've done is I've taken this region right here and I have just boosted slightly the intensity contrast in that area to make so we can see these tips of the fingers to roughly the same intensity that you see here. It's just easier for us to look at. I'm not adding information, I'm just taking what's there and computer exaggerating it. But I think you'd all agree that these fingers look nice and long and spidery, right? In fact, they look like something that you'd see out of an X-ray. So what I did is I took my hand, we X-rayed it at a local hospital in Colorado Springs, and this is what we had. I kind of blurred the image because I wanted to kind of get it to looking like what we see on the shroud. Forget these crosshairs. That's just the metallic crosshairs in the X-ray. But what we do find is that right here, we have a structure that correlates with that structure. And the question is, what is that? Well, if we sharpen the X-ray, we can find out. It is my thumb curled underneath the palm of the hand. And you can see it right here. Compare it to this structure. We see the elongated fingers, just like you're seeing on the Shroud of Turin.